Good morning. Welcome to our church this morning. It's a great day. It's our last Sunday in this building, and but not our last Sunday of worship. We just look forward to an adventure, actually. We're about to go on an adventure, and every adventure I've ever gone on that God has led has been very enjoyable. And so let's just open up this time of prayer and enter into our worship. Father, there's many things in my heart this morning. But Lord, you are the same. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And you never change. Lord, all of your promises you fulfill. And we can always trust, Father, when there's many things we don't fully understand, we can always trust that you are in control. And so we thank you, Lord, just for your love, your presence, for your unchanging nature, and for your unending love. Thank you, Lord, for this morning. And we ask, Father, that for each of us here and also for those watching at home, that this would just be a really special and unique time. Father, open up our hearts to receive your word and to receive life from you. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And let's stand for worship.
Christ is ours. Now you can sit.
I was at St. Giles this morning. It was a really enjoyable service. A lot of people laughing. I made a small mistake in the church, and I'm not a Mac person. I don't know how to operate a Mac, but that's what they have for their PowerPoint, and it wasn't totally my mistake because the Mac wasn't plugged in. They turned on the computer on, and then it went to sleep, and then when I turned it on, it just reset everything. It stopped projecting to the screen. I didn't know how to get it to project again. And so they had no PowerPoint, and they had no music, or they didn't have words, and they had to distribute the hymn books, and then I didn't have PowerPoint for my message, and so it was a bit of a mix-up for me. And apparently, I just got here like 10:45 because their service is at 10, and I had to run over here afterwards. And apparently, I'm a little bit mixed up too, as I came up after only two songs, not realizing that we had one more. Of course, people watching TV, watching online, wouldn't have known that. But anyways, I have a tendency to just keep talking when I'm a little bit frazzled. But I'll get out of that mode. Okay, I'm out of the mode. Good. Just some announcements. So right, today is our last day in this building. From next week, we'll be at St. Giles Building, and the service is at 10 a.m., okay? Service is at 10 a.m. And the good news, the very good news, is the pastor there told me, gave me a time limit for sermons. He said 20 minutes. Mine are usually like 30 to 40, but he said 20 minutes. 30 is... it's okay, just not ideal, but 20 minutes is a target. So that's the good news, right? Services will be nice and tight, and I won't be putting people to sleep, as I usually do. All right, another announcement, Orange Day. Orange Day is this coming Thursday. It's called the Truth and Reconciliation Day, Orange T-Shirt Day, rather. People are being called to wear orange T-shirts, but you'll actually just start seeing people wearing orange T-shirts throughout this week, because the schools, at least the public schools, they don't necessarily observe it on Thursday. It'll just be within this week, and so you'll see that. And you know, if your company allows, maybe you can wear an orange T-shirt on Thursday to work. That's all the announcements I have, I think. Just a note about, I wrote in the email that there's going to be bread and grape juice with you. If you were the first four or five to arrive, your bread is going to be quite hard and a little bit stale. If you want, you can switch with another baggie at the back. It'll be a little bit softer. But I did say that consumption is optional. You don't have to consume it. These are the grape juice and bread, as you would know. These are communion elements, and some people have it would not be comfortable receiving communion elements from a person who's not been ordained, and I have not yet been ordained. And if you're that kind of a person, this is just grape juice and bread. Some people say that if you're not a believer, that you should not partake in communion. I don't believe in that. If you're not a believer, it's bread and grape juice. But if you are a Christian, it has a much deeper meaning for us, and that is that Jesus Christ died for us. And so the bread represents his body that was broken for us, and the grape juice or the wine represents his blood that was shed for us. And so when you're a believer, if you're a believer, hopefully everyone's a believer, that is what you can think about if you do decide to consume the elements that we have here today. They are entirely optional, and I did write it in the email so that the people watching at home can prepare that ahead of our service today. Let's open up in a time of prayer. Father, we thank you again for this time. Lord, we are just curious about this message title, Into the Unknown. Father, there's many things in our lives that are really unknowns, and they're just waiting for us to discover. I think sometimes, for some people, not all, That unknown is really after high school for people who don't really know what they want to do or what they want to study. So, but even after university, there's so many things that come into our lives, Father, that are new, that we've never experienced before, and we just don't know what happens next or what to do next. But what I know of you, Lord, of all of the different things that you've led me to do in my life, there's been many, many unknowns in those things, Father, because sometimes the things that you call me to do are very simple and vague, and that begs just information. It begs more information so that I can know exactly what I need to do. But I know, Lord, that the way that you operate, this is not entirely the best way. Help us, Lord, to understand your word today, and help us, Lord, to just trust in you completely. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So into the unknown. This was a screen grab. Of course, this refers to some sort of a video related to Frozen, the epic version, whatever that means. But this is really, as we enter into St. Giles, as we move as a congregation into St. Giles, there's really a lot of unknowns. There are known things. There are known things like, joint services and things like that. But there's a lot of unknown things, such as what children's and youth ministry will look like. Because it's not just the EM congregation that will move. There will be many departments that will move as well. At least the children and youth I know of, and possibly the young adults, except for that one, I'm not entirely certain. But anyways, many people have a lot of questions about what we're doing, and I cannot answer majority of them in regards to moving to St. Giles. People have been asking me questions, what's going on, what's happening, is this being dissolved? No, EM is not going away. But then there's really a lot of questions I can't answer, and really no one else can answer either because, a lot of things are still being worked out. So I wanted to talk about this being our last day here in this building, just to see what is it that God is doing? What is it that God often does in our lives? This is not just our move to St. Giles, but this is really our life in general. What is God doing in our lives? And why is it sometimes that what God calls me to do is somewhat vague, somewhat unclear? Okay. So into the unknown, we don't know what we are walking into. So we want to have certain questions, answers, who, what, where, why, when, and sometimes how. All of these little passages underneath our title, which is a little bit of an overlap there, but they all have to do with do not be afraid, be encouraged. Every one of those passages. I won't be reading every one of them. In fact, I won't be reading any of them. But they're there for your reference, and you can see them again at our YouTube channel if you want to get the full list. But these are the who, what, where, why, when. These are the five W's of life. This is what most people need to know or want to know in regards to their life. Okay, it could be in regards to a decision, but generally the five W's of life. I'm only going to be reading the main passage, which is Matthew chapter 6, verses 33 and 34, which is right there. Okay. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today. Okay. So seek first. There is an order here. There is an order of tasks here, and God is calling us to seek him first. Now, we live in an information age. Okay, surprise, surprise. I didn't grow up in an information age. The first personal computer, I think I was in grade 10 or 11 is when the first computer, personal computer came out. It was an Apple. It was actually called an Apple Macintosh. It was this big clunky thing, and it had green letters on a screen. Most of you here have no idea what I'm talking about, but those were the days, okay? 1 billion gigabytes of data. 1 billion gigabytes of data is called an exabyte. Let's call it an exabyte. Prior to the information age, all the words humans had spoken since the dawn of time equaled 5 exabytes of data. This is from the very, you know, from creation. Everything that we have spoken is about 5 exabytes of data. In 2025, that amount of data will be reproduced every 15 minutes. We live in an information age. We have access to information. In fact, we have access to almost all of it with our phones. Okay? There's more technology in our phones today than there was when NASA sent astronauts to the moon. Cool, eh? Maybe scary. Sometimes scary, I think. But anyways, we live in an interesting time. Now, we have access to this information, and this is also, we can also see this in certain other phrases, such as informed consent, informed decision making, keep informed, well informed, educated, knowledgeable, versed, or even well read. Okay? This is all in our lives, and we have access to all of it. For any venture you get into, you would be considered a fool if you did not plan properly, right? So vacations, not just any vacation to Banff, but expensive ones, home buying, investments, education, retirement. Retirement's a big one. Moving to a new city. And all of these things take a lot of planning and preparation. And if, you know, if you're found to not have done very much and you just kind of on the fly did something and something not so good happened, you'd be considered a fool of not considering all of these different things or not planning properly. And these are the things that we grow up with. These are the things that become expected of us as adults. We need to have everything. We need to have all the information. Okay? And we might even prepare a backup plan for some of these things. For any venture, when things do go well, people will say, yeah, you were well prepared. Good job. Right? You did your homework. You planned well. These are good things. What I know of God and his different callings in our lives is that God is intentionally vague. He's intentionally unclear in some of the things that God calls us to do. I'm going to go through a few stories in the Bible in the Old Testament, one in the New Testament, but Noah's Ark, okay? So Noah received specific instructions on how to build his ark. It was very clear. It had to be this long, this wide, this high. It was very clear what Noah had to do. And that was the only thing, except for God said, I'm going to put rain on the earth. That was it. That was all that Noah received. He didn't know how long he had to build the ark. He didn't know when the rain was going to come. It's quite possible, the movies don't show this, but it's quite possible, as I read scripture, that Noah had finished the boat. It's sitting on dry land. It could have sat there for like a year, and not a single drop of rain came down. So Noah knew. It was very clear what Noah had to do, but the rest of the information wasn't given, right? You're going to go out and build here in our day today, if you go out and build a boat in your backyard, well, you probably have already figured out, how am I going to get it to the water? Especially if you build a big boat. You need a trailer. And then you need to drive it somewhere. You know, where are you going to go with this boat? But Noah wasn't given this information. But it was clear that he had to make one. The call of Abram. Okay, he's not Abraham yet. This is before his name changes to Abraham. The words of Abram's call is this. Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. Well, this is interesting because God doesn't tell Abram which way to go. Right? I remember I heard one speaker say, well, it's possible that there were mountains all around Abram except for one side where he could just go in that direction. Right? I don't know. But if we look at the text very carefully, it says, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you, which means you're already going before God is going to show you the land. Right? It's a future tense, to the land I will show you. It's a future tense, which means God will show him where he's going to go, but that's later. Right? So, but it's clear. It's very clear that he had to go. It's very clear. But he's going to find out where he's going later. It's quite interesting. We're told that Abram went to Canaan. After arriving in Canaan, God then tells him, this is the land I'm going to give you. This is after he arrives. How he got there, I have no idea. Was he saying, okay, God, which way do I go? Which way do I turn? I don't know. But all I know is he wasn't told where to go. Moses. God calls Moses to lead people out of Egypt. Okay, it's clear from this instruction that Moses' next steps is to go back to Egypt. That part is clear. Okay, but unlike Noah and Abram, Moses retorts. He's asking God questions, and it's almost like who, what, where, why, when. Okay, I don't have this on the screen, but I'm just going to read it to you. Exodus 3:11. But Moses protested to God, who am I to appear before Pharaoh? Who am I to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt? Verse 13. But Moses protested, if I go to the people of Israel and tell them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, they will ask me, what is his name? Then what should I tell them? Chapter 4, verse 1. But Moses protested again, what if they won't believe me or listen to me? What if they say, the Lord never appeared to you? Verse 10. But Moses pleaded with the Lord, O Lord, I'm not very good with words. I have never been, and I am not now. Even though you have spoken to me, I get tongue-tied, and my words get tangled. Verse 13. But Moses again pleaded, Lord, please, send anyone else. And then after this, God gets angry. Moses he's just making too many excuses. He's coming up with too many questions, and he just gets angry. But it was clear what Moses had to do, which was to return to Egypt. Now, I don't know if before Moses asked his questions, if God would have gone further and said, this is what you're going to say to Pharaoh. I'm pretty sure God didn't do that. With the way that I've seen that God act with different biblical characters, it's not like, you know, so go to Egypt and then say this to Pharaoh, and then if he doesn't respond, do this. I don't think that happened. I think Moses had to go first. And then when he got there, God was going to show him what he would do next. Joshua chapter 6. God told Joshua to march around Jericho once a day for 6 days and then 7 times on the 7th day. These instructions are quite clear. Okay. Oh, and then God also says make a bunch of noise after the 7th day and 7 times walking around and the walls of the city would fall. And then you're going to march in and take over the city. Those were his instructions. That's it. Okay. It's very clear what he had to do. And he actually did it. It's very clear. In every story, it was clear what God was calling them to do. Also in every story, not all the information was given. Except for Moses, because he kept questioning God about his concerns. Last story. This is Saul, not Paul. In 1 Samuel 13, King Saul. Okay, so Saul was instructed to wait for Samuel's arrival to perform the burnt offering. Okay, and so he waited for 7 days, and Samuel still did not show up. So then what does Saul do? After 7 days, he gets worried, right? Because he, you know, some of the soldiers, they're getting bored or they're falling away, they're losing hope or whatever. And so what does Saul do? He didn't wait. He said, go get the burnt offering and I will do it myself. He does the burnt offering and then the peace offering. And then Samuel shows up. And then Samuel says to him, what did you do? I told you, wait for me and I will do the burnt offering. And then God will make your kingdom last forever. But since you've done this yourself, God will take the kingdom away from you, and he has given it to someone else. And he's talking about David. Okay, so Saul gets rebuked. It was clear what Saul had to do, but he took matters into his own hands. Okay, here's another example. If God told you to go to Costa Rica, establish a school with a dormitory for orphans, what do you think you're going to do? If I receive this calling, I'm going to start with a design. I'm going to calculate the costs. I'm going to find out where I can get these materials, right? It's not like I'm going to ship these materials from Canada, so I'm going to go online, you know, access to the information age. I'm going to go online. I'm going to find out all these hardware stores in Costa Rica that probably don't exist, and then try to figure out how I'm going to get all these materials. I'm going to start fundraising for this project. God has called me. You know, I'm going to stand in front of the church. God has called me to build this dormitory for orphans and a school. And, but, you know, I would like you to get involved, right? To capture this vision and get involved and give. And then if no money comes in, you might get mad at God because you're like, God, you called me to do this, but money isn't coming in. So, you know, what's going on? You're certain that this is exactly what God has called you to do. And this is the problem with giving you too much information. Okay? It might be easier for God to be vague and just tell you to go to Costa Rica. Right? And we actually hear this a lot. We hear this a lot. We hear people being called to a country and they go. And then sometime down the road of being in that country, they get this vision that God wants them to build a school. And then they start planning and you know, they might ask God, well, I got no money, so, you know, what do I do next? Right? And they might call people at home and say, you know, God gave me this vision and he's told me what to do, but I was wondering if you could just help out a little bit and then just see where that goes. Do you get how being vague in a call actually works better? It works better for you and it works better for God because this is what God wants. There's a little bit more to that of what God really wants. But let's just kind of go on and I'll get to that. Matthew chapter 10, verses 7 to 10, it says, go and announce to them that the kingdom of heaven is near. This is Jesus talking to the disciples. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cure those with leprosy, and cast out demons. Give as freely as you have received. Don't take any money in your belts. No gold, silver, or even copper coins. Don't carry a traveler's bag with a change of clothes and sandals or even a walking stick. Don't hesitate to accept hospitality because those who work deserve to be fed. Now, Jesus is sending his disciples out to share about the kingdom of heaven and to do ministry. Okay? But the instructions are very specific. Don't carry money. Don't carry extra clothes. Now, this is not a day trip. This is not a day trip. They're expected to... don't hesitate to accept hospitality because those who work deserve to be fed. Okay, they're expecting to sleep somewhere, but that's it. Okay, no money, no food, no extra clothes. These are my questions. Where am I going to eat? How will I eat? Where will I sleep? That's a very important question. Where am I going to sleep? When my daughter graduates high school and she says she wants to go to Vancouver with a bunch of friends and I know she doesn't have money, I'm going to ask her, where are you going to sleep? What are you going to eat? How are you going to eat? And I'll probably say no to her. Right? But God does this. Jesus does this. And they don't have all the answers. If I don't have all the answers, then maybe I shouldn't go. Because I don't know these things. This is very irresponsible. This is complete opposite of what we learn here in the West. Right? When our children become adults, we teach them, you got to be responsible. You need to know. You need to know these things. Plan well. And I'm not saying that these are bad things. These are actually very good things. But this is not how God does things with us. And so when God does these things with us, and it's so different from the way that we live our lives, we get confused. We get lost easily. Okay? God's call is quite similar to driving a car at night. And when you start, you can't see your destination. You might know where you're going, but you can't see your destination. But as you move forward, you see more of what you need to see. This is what God's call is like. But the key here is you need to move first. God has called you to something. You need to move first, not plan first. That's not totally true. You could do some planning. But what God really wants is for you to ask him, what should I do next? This is what God wants you. Now, let's say God tells you where he wants you to go. Okay, so we've got the stick man at the bottom left and the checker flag just up to the right a little bit. Okay, so let's say you do get a call and you do know where you want to go. Now you plan. This is the planning stage. So how do you get there? Do you know the way? And then, as I'm figuring this out, I would say that this is the logical route for me to get there and the most financially responsible, right? If I'm you know, asking people to support me on this journey, then I'm not exactly, let's say, you know, God calls me to go to Taiwan. I'm not exactly going to go to Australia on people's money for vacation before I go to Taiwan, right? So this is really the most financially responsible, and this makes perfect sense. It's the shortest way. I don't have to spend much money. I can get there easily. I found my way. I found an RV or bus or whatever, and I can get to this destination very easily. More often than not, this is the route that God would call you to do. More often than not. Okay. Now I know this is just a very simple map, and it's only, you know, off by an extra couple of blocks. But you just kind of imagine that this could be an international thing, or it could be within the province, or even across Canada. It could be anything much larger than this. But more often than not, this is the route that God plans for you. This is the route that God wants you to do. But then in the beginning, when God says, "I want you to go to this checker flag right here," what God wants you to do next is possibly maybe come up to this intersection here and then say, "Okay, God, what do I do next?" Or even before you even start driving at all, "Okay, God, you've told me that you want me to go here. What do I do? How do I get there? What should I use to get there?" This is how God often works with us. And I've got a picture of a bag of money up there, right? It's quite possible that God wants you to do this out-of-the-way route so that you can pick up a bag of money before you get to your final destination. And God actually does this quite often. I've heard so many testimonies of so many people of the way that God works. It is amazing. It is amazing, amazing, amazing. Even people like picking up an envelope of money. But anyways, more often than not, this is how God works. But we wouldn't know this. We wouldn't know this if God gave us a destination and then we went into the planning stage, getting informed. We need to be informed. And we would figure out on our own how to get there. And sure, your way could be efficient. It could be very good. But it's not necessarily what God wants. It's a bag of money, but sometimes God wants you to meet somebody before you get to your destination. Maybe God wants you to pick somebody up. And then you go to a destination, and then you find out where you need to go next. Okay? So quite often, this is how God works. And this is how God has worked with all of these different characters in the Bible. This is how God does it. When Jesus sent the disciples out, don't take money, don't take clothes, don't take anything, he didn't even tell them how long they're going. And I don't even know when they knew they should return. Right? Isn't that odd? "Mom, I'm going on vacation." "Well, how long are you going?" "I don't know." "No, you can't go." "I want to know that you're going to come back alive, right? I want to know that you're not going to do some free diving for the first time in your life, right?" And we didn't know. So quite possibly when the hospitality stopped, right, the disciples were like, "Oh, we don't have anywhere to stay, so let's go back home." And then eventually they all got back together again. Now, I don't know if that happened on the same day. I wouldn't be surprised if it did happen on the same day, that all the disciples just showed up on the same day. Right? And that's how God works. That's how God works. Very unique. Very amazing. God wants to know. And God wants to know if you'll trust and obey. When you go or do by faith first, the next steps are revealed. This happens so often. It's amazing. I have so many stories of exactly that. You got to go first, and then God reveals what happens next. There was a guy. Neither picture are good. That didn't do anything. I wanted to blank the screen out. There was a guy who he was called to. He's like a seasoned or just a skilled speaker, and he was called to give a message. He was called to a revival meeting, and he had never given a revival meeting ever in his life, and he had his testimony ready. This is aside from career, sometimes the career thing is, the career question is an unknown, but especially when you finish university, right? You try to get your job, and then what do you do with your life? God calls us. In fact, there's maybe not a single moment that God doesn't call us, even during university or in high school. God is always calling us to do something. But quite often, those calls are vague. At least from our point of view, they're vague because not all of the information is given. And for us to function, we need information. We need to be informed for us to function. We need that. But that's not how God functions. And the reason why God doesn't function that way is because God wants us to trust him. Right? So God tells us to a task, and as a guy, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to plan. I'm going to solve problems. I'm going to think about it. But the first thing God wants us to do is to ask him. Okay, God, you've called me to this place, or you called me to do this. What? How do you want me to do it? Right? If it's somewhere else in the country or overseas, well, how do I get there? Especially if I don't have the money, I can't afford it. How do I get there? How do I get the funds? How do I do it? I know one of the answers is to ask the church, right? But that's like an instant response. I didn't ask God to know that. I just know that. But that's not what God wants either. God doesn't want you to default to what you know. He wants you to ask him so that you can have this relationship that God wants to have with you, so that you can follow him every step of the way. And by following him every step of the way, you actually get more blessed because God opens your eyes. He gives you experiences that you never expected. He shows you things that you never expected. And that's because you just trust God all the way. When we plan and we find the most efficient way of using people's money most efficiently, we miss out on other opportunities because we just do things on our own. Right? And sometimes we, even before you get called to something, you just want to go somewhere. Hawaii has this Christian YWAM, Youth with a Mission. They've got this Christian university. You know, so I'm just going to get on a plane. I'm going to go there. And then after I arrive, I will say, okay, God, I'm here. What do you want to do? Right? You don't do that. God doesn't work that way either. And he can use you there if you operate in that fashion. But typically, the way that God works is he'll give you something, but he wants you to respond to him in obedience. He wants you to trust him. If you can't see where his hand is leading, can you trust his heart? Can you trust God's heart? Okay. Although we are entering into the unknown, we will be faithful to what we know, what we do know, and wait on God to reveal more opportunities in working together. God wants to know if you'll trust and obey. We'll meditate on these thoughts with a song. You don't have to.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. My life,
I have asked Pastor Young to come and give us the benediction. Pastor Young has been with our church the longest of all the pastors at our church. He's been with us the longest, and I've asked him to give the benediction, but also to give us a commissioning and a blessing as we move to St. Giles. Would you come, Pastor Young?
Hello, everyone. I know some of you guys know me, but some rest of you guys don't know me, maybe. So I need to introduce myself, but actually Pastor Lam interest about me. So actually I'm in charge of a young adult group in KM. And I've been pastoring here for more than 8 years, I think, yeah. So longest one, oldest one, maybe. Yeah, but I'm so glad to be here to give you guys God's blessings. Let's pray, okay? Thank you, Lord, for gathering us together to worship you and praise you. Lord, we live in such an uncertain age where people wander around not knowing where to go. However, we give thanks to you for guiding us to a certain direction. We thank you for giving our English ministry to open up a new journey. We invite your Holy Spirit to pour out onto the people and onto their journey. As Pastor Lam preached today, we are heading to the unknown. But we are glad that you are with us and guiding us. We don't know the exact place, but we know our direction because you are guiding us with a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Lord, pour out your blessings and grace upon English ministry and give strength and wisdom to Pastor Lam. Bless all the congregation in EM. We trust you, Lord, and we love you, Lord. May the grace of our God, our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen.